Estás escuchando KBBF 89.1, Calistoga, Santa Rosa y gran parte del norte de California.
You're listening to KBBF 89.1 FM, Calistoga, Santa Rosa, the voice of your community.
El departamento del sheriff del condado de Sonoma ofrece oportunidades de empleo en la posición de oficial correccional. Esta posición incluye beneficios. Para más información y para lanzar su carrera en el departamento del sheriff, visite www.upad2sonomacounty.org. El último día para entregar solicitudes será el 13 de septiembre.
Can't afford a down payment on a home? Tired of renting? Do you and your family want a place to finally call your own? We'd like to tell you about an exciting home ownership opportunity through Burbank Housing. Catalina Town Homes is a 60-home community in an emerging neighborhood located less than a mile from downtown Santa Rosa and the Santa Rosa Marketplace. Catalina Town Homes is available to buyers who have not owned a home in the past 3 years, have good credit, steady income, and a desire to build a home and a community. Burbank Housing works with owners on the construction of their three-bedroom, two-bathroom home, so the homeowner's sweat equity counts as a $20,000 down payment. A lower fixed monthly payment means that you can predict your housing cost starting as low as $1,450 a month. Come discover Catalina Town Homes and everything our location has to offer. For applications and more information, visit www.catalinatownhomes.com or call us at 707-526-9782.
Un informe de la educación pública. La película Precious Knowledge cuenta la historia del programa de estudios México-Americano en Tucson High School. Los líderes estudiantiles luchan para salvar sus clases con textos, Facebook y megáfono. Precious Knowledge se va a exhibir solamente una noche, el miércoles 16 de septiembre, en el Cine Rialto, ubicado en 6868 McKinley Street en Sebastopol. Las puertas se abren a las 6:30 p.m. y la película comienza a las 7 p.m. La admisión es de $10 para beneficiar KBBF Radio y el Club Latino Demócrata del Condado de Sonoma. Para información, llame al 707-525-4840.
A report from the front lines of public education, the film Precious Knowledge tells the stories of the Mexican-American Studies program at Tucson High School. Student leaders fight to save their classes with texts, Facebook, and a megaphone. Precious Knowledge shows one night only, Wednesday, September 16th at the Rialto Cinemas, located at 6868 McKinley Street in Sebastopol. Doors open at 6:30 p.m. and the film starts at 7 p.m. Admission is $10 to benefit KBBF Radio and the Sonoma County Latino Democratic Club. For information, call 707-525-4840.
KBBF 89.1 FM, conquistando tu corazón.
All right. Hello, everybody. You are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show, and this is on KBBF 89.1 FM Calistoga. The Queer Life Radio Show, which is LGBT news, modern perspectives, roundtable discussions, and interviews here on KBBF 89.1 FM Calistoga. I am your host, Kaiya Kramer, and this show airs live every Friday night, 6 to 8 p.m. in the San Francisco Bay Area, reaching all the way up to Redding and down to the South Bay Area. We are live every Friday night, and this replays every Tuesday night from 9 to 11 p.m. on KBBF 89.1 FM and is syndicated every Wednesday night, 6 to 8 p.m. on KWTF 88.1 FM Bodega Bay. All episodes are streamed live from the studio via Google Hangouts On Air, which you can watch on thequeerlife.org. TheQueerLife.org has an archive of every single episode, links to all news, topics mentioned, descriptions, and info for all guests interviewed, access to Trans Atheist Podcast and Lesbian Honest Podcast, exclusive podcasts from the Queer Life family, and support pages for crisis hotlines and access to mental health professionals for those who are absolutely in need. Please like us on Facebook, facebook.com/thequeerlife. Follow us on Twitter, @thequeerlife. Subscribe to us on YouTube, youtube.com/thequeerliferadio. Disclaimer, what you hear on this show should not be taken as strict legal or medical advice. Please use your own discretion and check with a lawyer or doctor to directly address your legal or medical needs. If you are enjoying this program or any other programming on KBBF, visit kbbf-fm.org and hit the donate button. All your donations are greatly appreciated. Again, I am your host, Kaiya Kramer, and you are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show. Hello, everybody. Again, you are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show, LGBT news, modern perspectives, roundtable discussions, and interviews. I'm your host, Kaiya Kramer, and this is episode 57, Julia Serano interview. And I want to apologize because last week I was not on the show. I actually called in sick for the first time ever, and I'm sorry. I think I only get one sick day per year, I think. But anyway, last week should have been episode 57. But anyhow, I want to prepare you for a pretty special episode. I know I probably say that just about every single week, but I feel like all the episodes are special. But this one is especially special. Redundant. Anyhow, this is I'm going to be interviewing Julia Serano, and I'm also joined in part with Mandy Howard, who was a part of the Queer Life for a lot of the early episodes too. So she's going to join in on the interview and join in as part of the news and perspectives portion of the show. And so we've got a lot of interesting things to talk about for this episode. And so I'm just going to get underway here and introduce the guest for tonight's episode here, Julia Serano. I came across her as a recommendation when I remember when I was initially coming out as trans, and I was looking around for books to read, and this book that came across my radar was called The Whipping Girl. And I'm actually going to bring Mandy in on the call right here real quick. I've got Julia on hold. Mandy, come on in.
Hey.
All right. and I actually recommended this book to Mandy. When did I recommend this to you?
When we were in Barnes & Noble.
When we were in
and I was looking for a trans book to read. Trans related, right?
And I'm like, oh, this one might be good.
Yeah.
So let me introduce Julia here, and then I'm gonna bring her on the air. So this is Julia Serrano's bio from her website. Julia Serano is a true Renaissance woman, a writer, a performer, activist, musician, and biologist. She is best known for her book, Whipping Girl, a transsexual woman on sexism and the scapegoating of femininity, from Seal Press, a collection of personal essays that reveal how misogyny frames popular assumptions about femininity and shapes many of the myths and misconceptions people have about trans women. Since its publication in 2007, Whipping Girl has garnered rave reviews. The Advocate placed it on their list of the best nonfiction transgender books, and readers of Miss Magazine ranked it number 16 on their list of the 100 best nonfiction books of all time, and has been used as teaching materials in gender studies, queer, LGBTQ studies, sociology, psychology, and human sexuality courses in colleges across North America. I'm going to bring Julia on board here. Julia, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Thanks for having me.
Great. Thanks for joining us. So first and foremost, it's kind of interesting, you know, it's like I've been reading your book and then here I am talking to you. And the one thing that I noticed the whole time reading your book that I was like nodding my head the whole time. Is that the first time that you've heard that statement?
I've heard similar statements on a number of occasions, but thank you for that.
So the first question I'm going to ask you, and it's one that I generally ask every single guest on this show, is what are your preferred gender pronouns and identification in terms of queerness, also known as sexual orientation or movement along the spectrum of gender identity and sexual orientation?
Yeah, sure. So my preferred pronouns are she and her, and I identify a number of ways as a trans woman. And as a trans woman, I'm queer because I'm under the transgender umbrella. And also because of the fact that with regard to sexual orientation, I identify as bisexual.
Wow. Thank you for that. Yeah. And just
multiple queer stuff going on.
So you're a lot of parts of the rainbow there, it seems.
Yeah.
You know, and to explain to the listeners why I asked that, first and foremost, this show is called The Queer Life, and it's a sharing of queer-identified perspectives. Queer in terms of LGBTQQIA, sometimes A, sometimes another N in there, but which is lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, questioning, intersex, and asexual, yes.
And ally.
And ally.
Yeah.
Although some people disagree with us on that point, but so what for you in terms of what drove you to write this book, Whipping Girl, and can you tell us a little bit about it?
Sure. Yeah. So the book, it came out in 2007. I had the first like inklings of what I wanted to write about around 2003, 2004. And back then I was a much younger trans dyke who became very involved in Camp Trans, which is the annual protest of the Michigan Women Music Festival's annual, festival specifically there, the annual festival, but specifically the policy that was the quote-unquote women, boy and women policy that excluded trans women. And I became involved in that and in my work through that. And then also just generally both being a trans woman who is very active and kind of local queer. And every time I say the word queer, I'm saying it in the big umbrella way that you just said, the LGBTQ, QIA+, et cetera. Anyway, in my local queer community, and also just being a trans woman living in the world, I started to really notice how a lot of what I faced that a lot of activists would normally describe as transphobia or anti-trans discrimination, a lot of it was very rooted in assumptions that that femaleness and femininity are less legitimate than maleness and masculinity in our society. And this would play out in different ways. It played out in different ways in say queer communities than it did in like straight mainstream settings. But I became more and more cognizant of this problem in my own life and also seeing it in the world around me. And so I started writing pieces related to that. And I was lucky enough that around 2005, Steel Press, who ended up publishing the book, became aware of me and were kind of interested in publishing what I had to say. And so basically that's the genesis of the book in a nutshell.
For our listeners, could you describe some of what you were talking about? You were talking about the women born women, and for a lot of people it's like if it's a women's festival, why wouldn't trans women be allowed to go?
Yeah, so basically the festival had been around, so I should say that to the best of my knowledge, the festival had its last ever annual event this last August. So the festival is apparently in the past tense as far as I know. But for many, many years, like since the 70s, it was the largest annual women-only event in the world. And it was predominantly, it was run by and mostly catered to queer-identified women. And starting in the early 90s, they kind of retroactively instated a women-born, women-only policy, and it was purposefully used as a way to keep trans women from attending. And for listeners who may not know, there is kind of a long and sordid history of feminist responses to transgender people and trans women more specifically. These days, I would say most feminists that I'm aware of are welcoming of trans women and understand that transgender issues very much intersect with feminist issues, and that we're both talking about various forms of gender policing and gender oppression in our society. But at the time, there's a history of some feminists being very anti-transgender and specifically anti-trans women, and that's where this policy started. And so since the 90s, there have been multiple efforts and protests amongst trans people, especially queer-identified trans women, to try to get the policy lifted so that we could attend the festival if we wanted. And unfortunately, that never ended up happening there, although a lot of that protest and activism really did help make a lot of queer women's spaces more welcoming of trans women in the long run.
Right. I mean, I've reported on quite a bit of these feminists who are against trans women joining these spaces, and some of their arguments are along the lines of, and you know, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mandy, that it's sort of pollutes the presence of trans women pollutes the energy with men's energy, or
they use all sorts of excuses, most of which is discussed in Whipping Girl that Julia wrote.
And I should say, in the chapter that I specifically talk about this, it's called Bending Over Backwards is the name of the chapter. Mm-hmm. And I talk about how almost, and there are multiple, you know, I think if people on a gut level disagree with somebody or dislike somebody, they'll kind of pull the whole kitchen sink routine of finding any excuse that they can to deny your existence. And I one by one go through each of the standard responses in order to deny trans women the experience of being in those women's spaces. And I go on to say that every single one of them is anti-feminist at heart. Like you mentioned, trans women have male energy. And it's like, well, if you believe that trans women somehow have male energy, basically what you're saying is that men have like aptitudes and abilities and energies that women don't, right?
Yeah.
I think that's a very unfeminist thing to say. I think mm-hmm. that most feminists would argue that people are people, and you know, every single person has differing abilities, but just because you happen to be a member of one gender or the other doesn't mean that you can't automatically do specific things, so that you have, you know, certain aspects of yourself that other people don't. I mean, it strikes me as a very anti-feminist thing. Also, a lot of times, you know, a lot of the arguments that trans women shouldn't be there kind of invokes things like, you know, like chromosomes, right? Which mm-hmm. I don't know about you, but I'm not able to actually visualize people's chromosomes when I meet them.
Hey, your chromosomes are showing.
Yeah, exactly. And so anyway, there's a whole series of things. One of the things that I noticed that really struck me when I was at Camp Trans in 2003 was that a lot of the kind of arguments or attitudes against trans women attending were really rooted in the assumption that trans women are feminine, which some trans women are, but, you know, like women more generally, we follow all over the spectrum. So some trans women are very feminine and some, you know, not so much, and some of us are kind of in between. I personally identify as a femme tomboy, as far as my gender expression goes. And, but But there is one person who I got to know at Camp Trans, and he was a trans guy, and he told me that he had had, when he was talking about the policy with women who were going to the festival, one said, you know, I don't know why trans women would want to come to the festival. Aren't they afraid they're going to break a nail? and you know, for one thing, it's kind of ridiculous. You know, as a queer identified trans woman, I mean, like, basically, you know, A, I peel my nails anyway. But, right. But, you know, like, queer identified trans women aren't like, you know, all of us high femme and kind of a stereotypical image that people often have.
Right.
All trans women want these to be really, really hyper feminine, right? You know, some trans women are very feminine, but a lot of us aren't so. But the thing that really struck me about it was, wow, that was really a very misogynistic remark, right? Mm-hmm. It sounded like the type of thing that, like, I could imagine, you know, some, like, you know, dude bro who, you know, is like, you know, doesn't understand why a woman would want to play a sport,
right,
or like engage in like a hands-on, like fixing a car engine. And that sounds like the type of thing that some guy would say, oh, aren't you afraid you're going to break your nail? And that, not that specific line, but that plus a lot of other experiences really made me start to think about how, you know, traditional sexism, that the idea that female muscle and femininity are inferior, plays into how people see trans women. And it kind of makes sense because, you know, we live in a world where Sigmund Freud once said that, you know, well, all girls and women suffer from penis envy, and everyone just went, yeah, that guy's really smart. Yeah, that makes sense. Of course women want to be men. Of course women want to be masculine. And in that world, people who want to be female or want to be feminine, mm-hmm. not to reduce trans women's experiences to like a just wanting or just deciding to be female or feminine, it's a lot more complicated than that. But the fact that we're the only people on the planet who actively make decisions to live in the world as women, the fact that that happens, I think a lot of people are confused by it, specifically wanting to be a woman. And I think that a lot of the negative assumptions they have about us are rooted in that idea.
Yeah, well, it brings up a lot of cultural questioning for people at a very intimate level. I mean, it's like, and I'm sure Mandy can back me up on this. Like, we a trans person, and again, I speak from my own perspective as a trans woman. You know, I walk down the street and I'm privy to a number of different responses. All of which are demonstrated psychologically by the expressions on their face. I mean,
yeah.
But it's a question of what, as far as modern day society and at least American society in the year 2015, is a man? What is a woman? I feel like I'm, you know, to be or not to be, you know.
Well, even at my work, when I first came out, they told me that I had to come to work every day as a woman. And at first I acquiesced to that request and I said, of course. But it wasn't until later, actually, until reading Whipping Girl, that I kind of thought about that statement. And I thought, what did they mean to come to work as a woman? And I decided that even if I chose to come to work with a mustache, like grow it out, I'm still coming to work as a woman because right. I am one, so it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how I look. So I actually stopped wearing makeup to work all the time, because at first I would paint myself up like a geisha, and then people were like, "Why aren't you wearing your makeup?" I'm like, you know, so yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and I think this gets to the heart of, like, you know, conversations and attitudes about gender more generally, even outside of trans issues. I think that, you know, there's some people who have really rigid ideas of what a man is and what a woman is.
Mm-hmm.
If you cross those lines, people will accuse you of not being a real woman or a real man. And, you know, some of those lines are things that people who don't in any way identify as transgender.
Yeah.
You know, if you're a man and you dress kind of fashionably, people will all of a sudden start questioning your manhood. or if you're a woman and you stop shaving your legs, people will question your womanhood. If you happen to be gay or lesbian or bisexual, people will often question your manhood or womanhood. So this is something that happens, you know, like in general, where people have really rigid ideas. For some people, those ideas are less rigid. You know, it's like, you know, you can be a woman who's a CEO, you can be a man, you know, who happens to be gay, you can, you know, in some ways, maybe that in society, there's a little more room, breathing room, a broader kind of idea of what manhood or womanhood would be. And the thing that I think of, and I talk about this in the book, like I think when I first transitioned, I was genderqueer identified at the time. I didn't necessarily know that I identified as a woman, but I knew that I wasn't happy being male, and I knew that I had feelings that I should be female. Mm-hmm.
Could you explain genderqueerness to our audience?
Sure, yeah, sorry. Yeah, so genderqueer is it is one. There are other potential identity labels that one could use to express a similar thing, but genderqueer is an identity label that people often use to talk about identifying outside the male-female binary. So if you're genderqueer, you might think of yourself as some combination of male and female, or woman and man, or you might see yourself as neither nor. You might decide that you're neither of the two. And when I was kind of using the term, I felt that, you know, for a while I kind of identified as bi-gender, which is another similar way of saying the same thing. And I came to the conclusion that I thought I would be happier transitioning, but I didn't want to become somebody else or pretend to be somebody else. And so I struggled with that. I think like a lot of trans people struggle with, but also I think some people who are not transgender identified, some people also struggle with, which is, you know, am I a woman, am I a man? Do I not feel comfortable with these categories?
A human struggle.
I initially thought, I don't want to put myself in another box. Like, you know, being male felt like this box of just to live up to expectations. I'm like, I'm going to transition, but I don't want to put myself into another box. And so that's what I did. But then eventually, after a year or two of moving through the world as a woman, and some of it was kind of transitioning and experiencing changes in my physical body and everything related to that. And then at the same time, to move through the world and have people treat me as a woman, sometimes in good ways, sometimes in bad ways.
Right,
The types of discrimination that, you know, I knew would probably happen based upon what all my female friends had told me and what I've read from, you know, feminist writings I had read. But all those experiences hit you on a very visceral level. And I reached the point where I realized that I identified as a woman, and it's not because I was living up to some ideal of what a woman is or should be, but it was that I was moving through the world as a woman.
Right.
And so I think that, and so to kind of answer your question, I think that different people have different ways of thinking about what a man is and what a woman is. And I just kind of have a really, really broad, a broad idea that being a woman is moving through the world as a woman, understanding yourself as a woman, and women are all different from one another, and we all have different backgrounds, we face different obstacles. It's not a singular experience. It's we each have a different experience of being a woman, and collectively, I would say that that's what being a woman is.
Absolutely. It does make sense. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more. We're going to go away for a quick break to hear some words from our sponsors. But if you're just tuning in right now, you are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show, LGBT news, modern perspectives, roundtable discussions, and interviews. Again, I'm your host, Kaiya Kramer. I'm with Mandy Howard interviewing Julia Serano, author of Whipping Girl. We'll be right back. Julia, just hold on right now.
Okay.
We'll be right back. Enriquezca su acervo cultural. Escuche KBBF, la voz de la comunidad.
Estás escuchando KBBF 89.1 FM, Radio Cultura, Calistoga, Santa Rosa.
Hello, everybody. We are back. You are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show, LGBT News, Modern Perspectives, Roundtable Discussions, and Interviews. I'm your host, Kaiya Kramer. I am here with Mandy Howard, and we are interviewing Julia Serano, who wrote The Whipping Girl, which is a book that has been used in many college classrooms to talk about gender identity, femininity, gender expression, and is all around a pretty in-depth read, at least for my own gatherings here. During the break here, Mandy and I went over a certain part of the book that really stuck out to us. Mandy, what was that?
The part of the book that really stuck out to me was the portrayal of transgender women, specifically in the media, talking about the pathetic transsexual and the deceptive. And I'd love it if you could elaborate on that a little bit and then maybe talk about your feelings on the state of trans media today.
Yeah, sure, I'd be happy to. So I should point out, and especially since I'll talk about trans media today, I should point out that the specifically the chapter, it's called Skirt Chasers, Why the Media Depicts the Trans Evolution in Lipstick and Heels.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually started out, that was one of the first pieces I wrote that ended up being the book. And it was in a Bitch magazine, a feminist magazine, back in 2004. So
wow.
I wrote it back in 2004,
mm-hmm.
and it was really, it was about certain archetypes that are repeated over and over and over again in the media, and specifically, I talk a little bit about things like documentaries and, you know, like talk shows and everything, but
yeah.
mostly covering characters that existed, especially in film or TV shows, and it seemed to me at that time that almost all the characters fell into one of two camps. And so there was the, what I call, and I'm not saying that trans women are deceptive or pathetic, I'm
no.
talking about the archetypes. And so there are the deceptive transsexuals who you're not supposed to know is trans.
Mm-hmm.
And these are generally trans characters who pass, who blend in as non-trans or cisgender, and basically those characters often are meant to kind of provoke audiences, especially there's usually a reveal where you find out that the character is trans, and it's usually a reveal that audiences respond, you know, in a very kind of shocking, disturbing way, and so do the characters on the screen.
Mm-hmm. Oh, kind of like in Ace Ventura with the female officer.
Yeah.
Exactly, yeah. And that's one of the ones I use.
Or the crying game, yeah.
Yeah, and that one, yeah, actually, the Ace Ventura actually parodies the crying game, which had come out a year or two before. And that one, which the crying game is a serious movie, and actually, I think mostly a respectful depiction. You get to kind of respect the character and everything, but the male protagonist has an immediate negative reaction when he finds out that she's trans.
Yeah.
So anyway, so there's that type of character. And then the other type of character is basically the trans woman who you who doesn't blend in as cisgender, and who basically, because of her, you know, either male-bodied physicality, a lot of times these characters are played by male actors, and often they have kind of, you know, like masculine mannerisms.
Mm-hmm.
And these characters, you don't ever kind of, or the audience isn't supposed to ever see them as being really women, but these characters are also kind of not threatening because of that.
Yeah.
And a lot of times those characters are kind of seen as the lovable characters who you kind of respect. The two examples, or two of the examples that I remember talking about were in Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, there's the aging showgirl, and she always has witty lines. And there's also John Lithgow's character in The World According to Garp is another example. And these are characters you get to love, but they're also not threatening because you don't ever actually, you know, you're not supposed to see them as being actual women.
Now,
those are the two main archetypes.
Yeah. Now, would you say, for instance, a show that's on currently on Amazon, Transparent, would you say the character in Transparent falls into that category as being a what you would term as a pathetic transsexual?
Yeah, and so I should also kind of say, like, in addition to that, I think that there are kind of like stereotypes that exist, but there are also sometimes people who kind of fit the stereotypes in real life.
Right? Well, yeah, that's true.
Yeah, and so I would say that in general, I think that probably a lot of what audiences really like about Mara and Transparent is related to the same reasons why they, you know, like the other, like, pathetic transsexuals.
Mm-hmm.
In that, you know, they don't necessarily feel threatened, and these characters have the chance to kind of win over audiences. Often they're kind of, like, respected, you know, not necessarily respected as women, but respected as people who have gone through something and have learned something through the process. So yeah, so I would say that character kind of fits that bill, but I think that a lot of times any character that, and I should say this, that I know that the Jill Soloway, who created this show, actually gave copies of my book to the cast beforehand and everything. Like
that. Well, that's a good education.
After the fact.
Yeah.
So I guess that's why I'm kind of saying that I think that some of what's happening with these stereotypes is, you know, sometimes there are people who are purposefully wielding these stereotypes in order to provoke feelings in the audience.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But then sometimes just based upon whether people perceive the character as, you know, kind of blending into the cisgender woman or looking like someone who looks like a man in a dress, in quotes.
Yeah.
I think that the audiences kind of create these archetypes just as much as kind of media producers do.
And what is your opinion of a lot of the newer trans media that's out there? A show like Orange is the New Black, or Sense8, which I'm not sure if you're familiar with, or even the reality shows that are being done.
Yeah, and so some of these I've seen. So I've seen a few episodes. I saw about half the season of Orange is the New Black until it ended up being one of my partner and I. She wasn't as into watching it, mostly just because of it's kind of intense at the end of the day to watch a show set in the present. so we kind of, and sometimes it's based a lot on whether, you know, you and your partner can agree on shows to watch. So I've seen some episodes of that. And we both have watched Sensei. And I've seen some of the, you know, I don't watch a lot of reality shows. I saw one episode of I Am Cat. And I would say the thing that is most promising in the media is that over the last, especially the last 5 years, audiences have finally gotten to see and hear from actual trans people talking about their own experiences and often issues facing the trans community more generally.
Yeah.
From, you know, and I would say that from what I've seen, like Orange is the New Black, Laverne Cox's character is definitely a lot more realistic portrayal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and also the character in Sense8, like they're more realistic trans women characters than what we saw 10 years ago,
yeah.
Which is awesome.
Yeah.
But even more to the point, like Laverne Cox has had the chance to be this really vocal person who's done a lot of great activism, and you know, just getting the chance to see her being interviewed in settings where she, you know, has at times kind of in a really straightforward way, you know, like let media producers know that, or people interviewing her know, hey, that's not okay. Hey, what you just said is incorrect, right? You know, Janet Mock has, you know, she's hosting a TV show on MSNBC.
Yeah.
Like she's hosting a news show. Like, wow, that's pretty amazing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and, you know, Laura Jane Grace has been doing amazing stuff and had a series, I think it was True Trans, and has done lots of interviews. And so I think that the most encouraging part has been just getting to see a lot of trans people reaching audiences that people actually hear trans people talking in our own voices. And I would also say that media depictions have definitely gotten better. And while they're not always perfect,
yeah.
The thing that I think is really new now is I think people making films are aware of and concerned about actually the trans communities feeling like the character is appropriate in a way that never was the case before.
Mm-hmm.
And some of this is related to kind of trans activists complaining about characters.
Yeah.
Or glad, you know, kind of putting out statements about how this particular character or this particular use of language is problematic.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say in general, while there are plenty of, you know, really horrible trans depictions,
yeah.
Things have changed quite a lot in the last 10 years.
Well, I know from the book and from my own personal experience that the media really wants to, like, whenever they portray us, especially like news media, they want to have shots of us putting on makeup or struggling to put on stockings or walking in heels or something or dress shopping. and yeah, so
yeah,
you still see a lot of that.
Yeah, and it is kind of funny because people have, a lot of people have asked me, you know, like people in my life, you know, like, I mean, well, let's put it this way, you know, people in my life who are kind of outside of, you know, kind of the queer and feminism bubbles, but who obviously know that I'm trans and they know that I do trans activism and writing about trans issues. And I've had a lot of people ask me my thoughts about the whole Caitlyn Jenner public reaction. And the thing that I tell them is, and from their point of view, they're like, wow, people are really being supportive and everything. And this is totally true to a certain extent.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that I point out is that, like, I feel like the public support for Caitlyn Jenner has been a sign that, like, you know, what we kind of sometimes think of as transphobia, like fear of and hatred of trans people, that I think is very much on the decline.
Yeah.
But what hasn't changed hardly at all is kind of the fact that, you know, the double standards that exist where people view trans people's identities and gender expressions and bodies in an inferior and less legitimate way than they view people who are cisgender.
Yeah.
And that was really obvious with all the Caitlyn Jenner work. People who felt like they were being 100% supportive of her were still like calling her Bruce. Right.
Yeah, yeah.
And you were talking about the shots of makeup. I mean, I read about that in the Skirt Chases piece in Whipping Girl. And I talk about my experiences and other trans people's experiences where people who our media producers want to do shots of people putting on makeup.
Yeah.
And so it was kind of funny in the promo, one of the promo ads for her show, she's sitting there putting on makeup. And it's just like, yep, things, you know, the more that things change, the more they stay the same, I guess.
Yeah, well, I remember I was interviewed by Zoe Tur, who's pretty well known for Inside Edition. And the director had asked me for a shot of putting on makeup, and I compromised with a shot of me getting my hair done. and they definitely pushed a little bit to get that done. And I remember Zoe asking me if I was when I was going to get facial feminization surgery, as if that was a requirement for being trans.
Wow. I have heard some similarly not so good
yeah.
regarding her take on trans issues.
Yeah.
But exactly. And the one thing I talk about in the book is I think that because for a while it was kind of confused as to why it was really important to show trans women putting on, you know, makeup.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of realized that I think we live in a society where I think people think of feminine gender expression, of femininity, feminine dress, as people see it as really artificial, like masculinity is natural and femininity is artificial.
Right.
In people's minds. And because of that, I think also people in their minds kind of see trans people as being fake and being artificial. And
yeah.
I don't necessarily think they're doing it on purpose, like thinking through it this way, but I do think the fact that they see us as fake kind of really makes them want to show us putting on these feminine artifices, putting on clothes, putting on makeup.
Almost like a costume.
And it kind of reinforces both their ideas about femininity and about kind of trans people being, you know, like illegitimate women and men. I think that this definitely plays a role in why the media tends to be less interested in showing trans men, because I think trans men who are masculine gender expression, and we see masculinity as being natural, not artificial.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really hard. I think trans men to people like the general public, I think probably just come off as just looking like men in a way that they can't really show off the fakeness. But with trans women, like all you have to do is have shots of them putting on makeup and clothing. And one of the things I talk about in the book is specifically the movie Trans America, which, you know, it was like an Academy Award winning movie, I think, from like 10 years ago. If you watch that movie, in almost every single scene, she's either putting on and off clothes or putting on makeup, like over and over and over again.
Isn't that all women do, though?
And she's complaining about female clothing and female things, and just like Caitlyn Jenner does constantly. Like during her SB speech, she talked about how hard it is to be a woman. You know, I'm like, oh gosh.
and this is the thing. I think that for actual trans women, I think we all have different experiences, and I think that all of us go through, I know a lot of trans women who will refer to it as their 12-year-old girl phase.
Yeah.
There's a period where, you know, there's a lot of attention and symbolism put onto, like, things that are feminine clothing and makeup and all that. And a lot of it is kind of rooted around, you know, like kind of ideas about, you know, sexualized ideas about women and women's bodies, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so there's kind of like this cultural obsession with that. And then all of a sudden, you know, if you're either, say, a 12-year-old cisgender girl who all of a sudden is starting to, you know, to be at a point where you're starting to be seen somewhat as kind of, you know, a young woman or, you know, like reaching, you know, getting closer to womanhood, all of a sudden there's all this pressure on you. And a lot of times there's a huge period of time of kind of experimenting and sorting out things before you kind of get to the point where you feel kind of comfortable who you are.
Yeah.
And I think that trans women, regardless of our, you know, we often have very different trajectories from one another, but mm-hmm. I think a lot of us do go through a similar period of kind of figuring out, you know, in a world where there's all this symbolism that's kind of put on, you know, feminine gender expression and feminine clothing, I think that that's all there. So, and it is unfortunate. I am really grateful that I got to go through those phases of my life without it being on a reality TV show.
Come on, you don't want to be on MTV and have every little aspect of your transition monitored.
Well, I remember when I first met Kaiya, I think you caught me at the tail end of my adolescent phase as a trans woman, where I was wearing dresses and high heels every day. I still own all
fully
of my,
made up. Too.
Fully made up, yeah. Like a geisha. But I still own all of that stuff. I just don't wear it as much anymore. Yeah. I grew up.
Yeah.
But I mean, it even extends towards the as we've been espousing on this show numerous times, that gender identity and sexual orientation are two very different trajectories. But I know, at least at the beginning of my own transition, when I was in a relationship with a cis woman, everybody was asking me, "Oh, so when are you guys gonna break up, or when are you guys gonna move out, or whatever, you know?"
Yeah. And people, I had, when I transitioned, I was my partner was bisexual identified, and she, you know, we had things to kind of work out, or it was, you know, I mean, she was mostly worried that I'd change as a person. And, you know, we eventually many, many years, we split up for reasons completely, you know, unrelated to that. We amicably, separated, but at the time, people were really confused about why she's like, you know, like, why is she still with you? And it's like, well, because she's bisexual, and like, that's not a big deal to her. But people still couldn't wrap their brains around it.
Mm-hmm.
In your book, you talk a lot about that kind of duality between being of different levels of the gender identity spectrum, but also in terms of sexual orientation and the relationship between that. You yourself identify as bisexual. I know a lot of quote unquote straight or cisgender people have asked me, it's like, well, what if a trans woman likes another woman? What does that make her, you know? And it's this questioning and misunderstanding of what is somebody's sexual orientation. I don't know.
Well, it's like the media questioning whether or not Keanu Reeves is gay because he's dating a transgender actress.
Oh my gosh.
You know?
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, I guess I was in during the Diane Sawyer, Caitlyn Jenner interview, like, and she kind of asked, I think twice, about like sexual orientation type questions. It's like, what don't you get? Like, mm-hmm. Or what do you not get about this? But then things like that happen. Like, oh yeah, they just don't get it.
Yeah.
And a lot of it is, you know, just the assumption that, you know, no matter what we say about our gender identities, that we're all really still, you know, men or women underneath, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's just besides frustrating and besides invalidating, it's also just confusing because, you know, I mean, you know, I mean, I know lots of trans women. They come off to me as women. Like, there's not like any kind of weird, you know, there's not any kind of weird, like, you know, it's like, yeah, it's like, you obviously are a woman. You're moving through the world as a woman. You've transitioned. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, trans women don't come off as men to me in any way. And yet people still just can't, you know, get beyond it. It's, mm-hmm. you know, it's really frustrating.
Wow. So we are just about at the end of the first hour of the show here towards the end of the interview with Julia Serrano here. Mandy, do you have any last questions here for Julia?
I just want to say that I have read through the book, I don't know how many times at this point. You've seen my copy. It looks horrible.
Dog-eared.
It looks like it's been beat up, and it's highlighted all the way through. I have way too many questions. Maybe I can get them later.
Well, thanks. I really appreciate the kind words. I'm glad that, I feel really flattered. I mean, when I was working on the book, I was trying to write the book.
Yeah.
I felt would have really helped me when I was kind of like a teenager or a young adult.
Right.
I was dealing with all the mixed messages of both like kind of my own gender identity, but also living in a world where people have really negative views about femaleness and femininity. So I'm always really grateful to hear that the book kind of touched other people.
Yeah, well, for me, it really, and I want to say this to you personally, that it really helped me out to find myself as a trans woman. Like, it informed quite a bit of how I feel about the world and how I feel about being trans. I would start crying.
He's just starting to get emotional. Wow. Yes, Julia, thank you so much for giving us your time, sharing your knowledge, your wisdom, your abilities, and giving the world another hour of your brilliance.
Well, thanks again, and thanks for having me. I was happy to be part of a great conversation.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
All right, great. Thank you, Julia. We'll talk to you later. Take care.
Okay, take care.
Bye. Bye. Again, that was, if you're just tuning in right now, you are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show, LGBT news, modern perspectives, roundtable discussions, and interviews. I'm your host, Kaiya Kramer. I am with Mandy Howard, and we just interviewed Julia Serano, a writer, performer, speaker, activist, author of The Whipping Girl, and in 2013, the book called Excluded. You can find links to her website and the book, which I'm not telling you what to do, but I'm just saying that it's got a lot of information in it, a lot of really fairly accurate information in terms of the trans community, gender identities, cultural stereotypes, blah, 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 blah. Anyhow, stay tuned, because in the next hour here, we're going to be going into our news perspectives, and in this case, roundtable discussions on some interesting topics, such as a boss who asked a transgender woman, "What are you?" Thailand introducing the first law to protect LGBT people. A little bit of awesomeness from Elon Musk talking about terraforming Mars to Stephen Colbert in the science section of the show, because science affects LGBT. That's my argument for that.
Is it because we should definitely have some LGBT people on the mission to Mars?
Yeah, I mean, statistically speaking, we should.
Yeah. Although it might be a one-way trip, most likely.
Yeah. National Geographic, now owned by Rupert Murdoch. We're going to be talking about that, because I talk about how...
Okay, what section is that?
It's the section that where I say that basically we should get past all these LGBT issues because, you know, like polar ice caps are melting and like polar bears and stuff.
All you had to say was polar bears.
Polar bears and stuff. Star Wars is going to have a gay character in it. I love Star Wars. That's just... and more shenanigans from the circus of Kim Davis from the county clerk's office. Again, you are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show. We'll be right back after this short break. We'll be right back.
Está usted escuchando KBBF 89.1 FM Calistoga.
Can't afford a down payment on a home? Tired of renting? Do you and your family want a place to finally call your own? We'd like to tell you about an exciting home ownership opportunity through Burbank Housing. Catalina Town Homes is a 60-home community in an emerging neighborhood located less than a mile from downtown Santa Rosa and the Santa Rosa Marketplace. Catalina Town Homes is available to buyers who have not owned a home in the past 3 years, have good credit, steady income, and a desire to build a home and a community. Burbank Housing works with owners on the construction of their three-bedroom, two-bathroom home, so the homeowner's sweat equity counts as a $20,000 down payment. A lower fixed monthly payment means that you can predict your housing cost starting as low as $1,450 a month. Come discover Catalina Town Homes and everything our location has to offer. For applications and more information, visit www.catalinatownhomes.com or call us at 707-526-9782.
The 18th Annual Progressive Festival featuring booths, food, networking, and the music of Francisco Herrera and the Hubbub Club will happen Sunday, September 27th from noon to 5 p.m. at Walnut Park in downtown Petaluma. Featured speakers will include Susan Lamont and Peter Phillips. This event is co-sponsored by KBBF Radio, so be sure to come by the booth and say hi. For more information, call 707-763-8134. Again, that's 707-763-8134.
El 18th Festival Anual de los Progresistas ofrecerá variedad de puestos de información y de comida, oportunidad para establecer relaciones públicas y la música de Francisco Herrera y del Club Hub. Se llevará a cabo el domingo 27 de septiembre desde el mediodía hasta las 5 de la tarde en el Parque Huapica, ubicado en el centro de Petaluma. Entre los presentadores invitados están Susan Lamont y Peter Phillips. Este divertido evento está patrocinado KBBF. Por favor, asegúrese de visitar nuestra caseta para intercambiar. Para más información, llame 707-763-8134.
Right. If you're watching the video feed, you'll see how much of a dork that I am.
The biggest dork.
Dancing to this music. I finally, after a year, decided to add new music to the show, all of which is Creative Commons and I've given attribution on the website. This is that song that was just played is Solskogen 2015. It's a song called Move. And it's from BitBear Electronic. Just, I,
Anyway, enter the matrix. There we go. If you're just tuning in right now, you are listening to the Queer Life Radio Show. LGBT news, modern perspectives, roundtable discussions, and interviews. I'm your host, Kaiya Kramer, and I am joined this evening with Mandy Howard.
Never anything to say.
Never anything to say. You know, that's the point when you're listening to like NPR when they say, oh, thank you so much for having me.
Oh my God.
Like totally like axing my chances of ever getting on
on NPR.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
Oh my gosh.
Sorry, that's bad.
Actually, I forgot to say that when I did my interview over at KQD. I was supposed to say thank you so much for having me. In my like NPR voice, you know.
You know, I'd love to hear somebody say, you know what, I actually have better things to do, but those things fell through in my plans. So I was just
I'm
like,
here.
What the hell?
I'm not doing anything tonight. Might as well be here. You know?
I took about, you know, I'm going to take 30 minutes off World of Warcraft to hang out with you guys.
Actually, Metal Gear is waiting. So
Metal Gear. Oh.
Metal Gear, yeah.
Anyhow, if you are just tuning in right now, in the last hour we interviewed Julia Serano, author, activist, musician, poet, author of The Whipping Girl and Excluded. You can find that interview and more available on thequeerlife.org. If that URL is too difficult to type in or you don't know what a URL is, just go to Google, the one with the different letters now, and type in The Queer in Life. I swear to you that it's going to elicit excellent and amazing episodes. And now we are on episode 57. Yes, for those of you who are wondering, we are still on the air, and there's going to be another 52 episodes on top of this. I'm sorry to disappoint some of you. I like the idea that I'm dissenting with my voice.
Well, was there a campaign?
I feel like they're, you know, as we speak, there are pitchforks and torches.
Yeah.
And actually, I should not give anybody any ideas.
And curmudgeon-y people. Like,
yeah. You know, I still want the Westboro Baptist Church outside of KBBF.
That would be so great.
That would be amazing. I love their posters. I still want a Westboro Baptist Church poster.
I bet you could sell that stuff for like a lot of money for some reason. Like people would buy that.
Yeah, I feel like it would go down very well in the upper middle class to wealthy gay community.
well, pretty much if you get protest by them, that means you're doing a really good job at what you're doing. That's a sign of doing really well.
That's like the highest form of respect
an
LGBT activist could get. I mean, one day I hope to be so amazing that I have them picketing with very offensive signs outside mm-hmm. of the radio mm-hmm. station.
Would you then go outside with your own offensive signs?
I would join them.
I mean...
I would probably just have confusing signs, like... No.
Kevin Smith.
Kevin Smith's yeah. brother.
when they protested the movie Dogma, they thought it would be funny to go out and make their own protest signs against their own movie and join them in protesting. And they made these really horrible signs, and it's hilarious.
All offensive, all things that I can't say on public radio. Anyhow, here, this is non-commercial public radio, educational perspective, and we're going to edumacate you a little bit. And something that actually pretty interesting happened, and Mandy, who brought this to my attention, was policy has been changed in the prisons in regards to transgender women.
And I just want to preface that with, that's not what I'm telling you, that's in the news.
That's in the news.
Because I do work for the department, so.
Right.
Yeah, that's not me giving you the news. You're reading it off of a story. I just sent you the story.
Yes. Mandy just sent me a story from transgenderlawcenter.org/archives/11867? They need better URLs, man. Mm-hmm. This is like,
they need you to create their URLs.
They do. Knock, knock, knock. There, I don't know if anybody heard that, but no. I knocked on the desk.
I heard it.
Yes. So this is from the Transgender Law Center, who's been doing a lot of incredible legislation work in regards to trans rights all over the nation, which are in fact making ripples across the world. An incredible organization that is getting a lot of support from a lot of, I've been looking at their list of sponsors, and it seems like the entirety of Silicon Valley is backing them up.
Yeah.
You see companies like Apple and Salesforce and Facebook. And
Did we actually say what the news is? I think you were just saying it was changing its policy. I interrupted you.
Okay. Yeah. So this is about prison policy in terms of gender confirmation surgery, and this is from Transgender Law Center. After winning a historic settlement with the state of California, Shiloh Quine, a 56-year-old transgender woman held in a men's prison, will be the first transgender woman we know of to receive gender-affirming surgery while incarcerated. Mm-hmm. And they use the language here. This is the first.
As far as I know. The first one in the country. I don't know about the world, but definitely, to my knowledge, even the first one in the country. There have been other trans women in other states and even in here in California who've tried, and they've all either been dismissed, or the one trans woman who almost got the surgery, she was summarily paroled early.
Right.
Yeah. obviously this ruling changes the entire game, not only for the state of California, but possibly for the rest of the country as well. You know, it's once again, it's California leading the charge, even if they have to be led, right? By a lawsuit. But regardless, that puts California a step ahead of everybody else.
Would you say that this sets a precedent, speaking, at least?
No, it does. It definitely sets a precedent. But as a you know, as we've talked about when I was on the show previously, I am a correctional officer with the Department of Corrections. I do not speak for the department, right? But what I would say about it is that I don't want to see trans women or even trans men thinking that the department and going to prison is a good option for going to get your surgery. I don't want to go to prison. It's not a fun experience for anybody.
Especially not as a trans person.
Yes, especially not as a trans person. You don't want to come to prison. It's not worth your freedom to get the surgery. Now, if you're already there, then you know that this ruling is great for you because you're already there.
Yeah.
But I want to encourage and urge individuals out there who, you know, it may happen that they would look at this and say, you know what, I can't get my own insurance or I can't get this covered. I could commit a small crime and go to prison and get my surgery. And that's not what I, as a trans woman and as a correctional officer, would want to see.
Right.
You know, then that's the door I don't want to be opened. But I do believe, as a trans woman, personally, that the ruling is an amazing step forward.
Yeah.
And I believe it says some other
things
in there about besides surgery.
Yeah. In addition to providing her with gender affirming surgery as promptly as possible, quote unquote, mm-hmm. and moving her to a women's prison, the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, CDCR, is committed to changing its policies to allow other transgender people access to the clothing and commissary items consistent with their gender identity, and to revise its policies regarding access to all medically necessary treatment for gender dysphoria, including surgery. So access to commissary and clothing.
What that basically means is female inmates inside the female institutions in most states, not just California, they have uniforms that vary slightly. The colors are usually the same. You know, here in California, it's blue for the most part, depending on your custody level. And what it actually means is they get access to female inmate clothing and commissary. I'm assuming it's going to be stuff like basic makeup that other females in the institutions are able to receive. And again, just my take on it, not the official word. You know, I obviously cannot speak for the department. So I need to keep reiterating that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And from what we've seen in Orange is the New Black.
Yeah. Yeah.
They get what they get in that show.
Pretty much. Yeah. Yeah. As far as I know, I mean, that's what that statement means to me as a person who works.
Was it like, it's like mascara.
I don't know exactly lipstick. What they're actually allowed to have. You know, I'm guessing something like mascara and maybe eyeliner or lipstick or something like that. And, you know, basic stuff, not a whole lot.
Right.
Just the basics.
I mean, it's kind of interesting, though. I mean, exploring that as a concept, it's further adhering to our standards of the gender binary.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay, well, these are women. They need to have makeup.
They need to have makeup. Well, yeah. Obviously, they're not forcing them to buy the makeup. That's right, up to those individuals, so they don't have to wear the makeup. You know, like for myself, sometimes I wore makeup today to work. Sometimes, most of the time, I don't. But, you know, that's by my choice. And this just makes those options available to them to, in my opinion, to kind of help being trans in prison be a little easier. I mean, being in prison is not easy at all. But being trans in prison is even more so, you know, it's less.
And, you know, contrary to popular belief, just because a trans woman is in a men's prison doesn't mean that she'll like it.
No.
Because she, according to cultural stereotypes, mm-hmm. likes men. It's something that I've heard all too often. And it's disgusting to think that that's okay. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, even there was a headline recently about the guy the subway guy who mm-hmm. molested the kids.
Mm-hmm.
I think there was a headline on a newspaper that said, oh, well, he'll enjoy a foot long in prison or something like that.
Oh, wow.
And it's, I mean, that's rape culture. That's,
mm-hmm. that's they're promoting rape culture. Yeah.
And
no,
this,
rape is not anything. For me, it's not anything to joke about or laugh about. I would support somebody's right to do those things if they want to do those because they have the right to, but I myself would not engage in that.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Engage in talking like that.
Talking like that. Yeah,
yeah, not
we wanted
rape.
We could,
yeah,
no, I wouldn't.
Yeah,
no.
Illegal.
And talking about it in that manner and kind of demeaning how horrible and horrific an experience that is, you know, for anyone who's been in that position.
Yeah, that falls under cruel and unusual punishment.
Yeah.
So legislation is changing. Thank you so much, Transgender Law Center.
it's a huge, like I said, huge step. A very good thing, I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Moving on now to Huffington Post, Lila Shapiro writes, boss who asked transgender woman, what are you?
Is he asking, like, is she Puerto Rican?
Are you human?
Are you Martian?
Are you Klingon?
Klingon, Ferengi.
Furry.
Furry, tribal.
No, the trouble with them.
Maybe he belongs to a Harry Potter fan club and he wants to know.
Are you a Slytherin? Or
if she's Slytherin or she, you know, Gryffindor, I don't know.
Somehow I doubt this is a question of which Harry Potter house that she's in. Last November, Jessie Dye showed up at Summerford Nursing Home for what would turn out to be both her first and last day of work.
Wow.
The morning started well. Dai attended a series of training sessions, completed paperwork, received vaccinations. She was excited about the new job, and it seemed like there was a real future with the company, and they'd offered to pay for her training to become a certified nurse's assistant. Sounds good so far.
Mm-hmm.
But then over lunch, she was asked to go speak with Robert Summerford, the manager of the company, about her paperwork. She steps into his office, and then he asks, what are you? He asked her as soon as she'd entered his office. And Dai responds by saying, it was exactly like being punched in the stomach during a phone interview that she mentioned with a phone interview to the Huffington Post. The feeling wasn't entirely unfamiliar to Di, a transgender woman living in Vinetown, Alabama.
Oh, wow.
She came out 7 years ago and when she was 21. And since then, employment has sometimes been a challenge. Sooner or later, employees realize, as some of her did, that the identity on her driver's license doesn't match the gender of the person they've hired. But no employer or prospective employer had ever been as direct or as final as Summerford.
Wow.
After Di answered Summerford's question, explaining that she was born male and was in the process of transitioning to female, he asked her, quote, "What am I supposed to do with you?" And then he instructed her to get her things and leave the premises.
Wow. Let's say, you know, first it's Alabama, and you know, as far from what I know of, the discrimination laws in Alabama are not too strong.
Right.
I'm not saying that the people of Alabama are any one way or the other, but I do know that the laws in that region of the country tend to be a bit weaker than they are on like the coasts, for example. Does it say anything about her legal recourse or what she's doing?
Yeah, well, she's received support from the Southern Poverty Law Center with charges of discrimination. And what's actually happened here is that they were going to court, but this boss ended up settling out of court for an undisclosed sum.
A lot of money.
A lot of money, because you can't discriminate when you're in a point of hiring people as far as employment goes.
Mm-hmm. So I'm assuming there are some type of protections then in place for her in that state.
There are. Mm-hmm. And the laws protecting LGBT people from workplace discrimination are not as clear-cut as advocates wish. Despite more than two decades of effort, supporters have been unable to pass the Employment Non-Discrimination Act, which would prohibit bias in hiring and employment on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity. However, outside of Congress, there have been signs of progress. Last summer, President Barack Obama signed an executive order protecting federal employees and the employees of federal contractors from anti-LGBT discrimination. So work is being done. Legislation is being made, a lot of that in part due to the work at Transgender Law Center.
Well, it's like I don't remember the presidential candidate who gave this speech, but it was very recent, and it was talking about the recent gay marriage ruling, you know, legalizing gay marriage throughout the country. And the speech he gave was talking about the fact that you can get married on a Friday, over the weekend, have your reception, honeymoon, whatever, come back to work on a Monday and be fired for being gay. In other words, you can get married,
right?
But in a lot of these states, you can still be fired for being who you are, whether it's gay or trans, whatever. So obviously that means there's so much more work to do throughout the country and in the world.
Yeah, and this is only one of the reported cases, which, you know, and some would say, yeah, this turned out positively because she received a sum, but I think
it's not really a positive.
Yeah, the positive would have been that she got the job without question.
Yeah.
I mean, it's also another point that it's one thing for a boss to say, "What are you?" and then still hire you.
Mm-hmm.
And asking "What are you?" is
Well, I've been asked at my work, not what am I or what are you. They've asked me, do I identify as a woman or a man? You know, so a bit more specific and a little less offensive, I guess.
Right.
Right. Because, you know, at the very least, that individual wasn't assuming that I identified one way or the other, although I had wished it was obvious.
Right.
You know, but people that you work with, in this state or any other state, you know, and I'm sure you've experienced similar situations where people want to know not just what you are, but once they know what you are, they want to know everything about you. You know, what's between your legs, for instance,
and right,
make a little scissor motion. Have you had the scissors? Has somebody?
I feel like, you know, all of a sudden people think I know sign language because they seem to do scissors and guillotines.
Or chopping,
you know, or hedge clippers.
Well, thank you. That's flattering.
Yeah. Oh, have you scissors?
Scissor motion, yeah.
Oh, gosh. but it's, and I mean, it even goes so far as you know, in terms of what we were talking about with Julia in the last hour here about expectations, and you brought up the idea of the deceitful, the deceptive transsexual, the transsexual who is quote unquote so beautiful in terms of societal standards at what a woman is, that nobody would quote unquote know.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you look at the majority of trans women that are portrayed in the media, in just on the news and even in television shows, the majority of them nowadays look like cis girls. They look like they might pass or whatever. Right, you know, they're beautiful and gorgeous by those standards. And yet, as she was talking about in her book and in the way trans women have been portrayed previously, when it comes to a deceptive transsexual, it's the idea that you pass as a woman and everyone thinks you're a woman, but lo and behold, there's something special between your legs at the end, right? And then all of a sudden we're supposed to feel sorry for the protagonist who finds that his girl is really a guy, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's used as a way to drum up bad feelings for the protagonist. Like, oh my God, I feel so bad for you that you were tricked, you know? Just like when celebrities get quote unquote caught with a trans woman.
Yeah.
How about the celebrity was just seen out with a woman?
Yeah. If like Keanu Reeves and Jamie Clayton, all of a sudden he's got a gay lover.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Is Keanu gay? What's that about? Right. No. And
I mean, he's been accused of being gay many times over the years, but
yeah, well, that's from people who don't like his acting. So
yeah. He knows Kung Fu. Leave him alone.
And there is a new Bill and Ted movie coming, by the way. So
oh my,
that's great. Gosh. That's great nerd news for your nerd news.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing,
isn't it?
But I mean, it's also the idea too is why does it matter? First of, I mean, yeah, why does it matter at all if a man is with a trans woman? But also too, why does it matter if a man is with a trans woman and the trans woman has a penis?
Yeah.
And the trans woman wants to keep her penis.
Whether she's pre-op or post-op.
Yeah.
It doesn't really matter as long as that's what that woman wants.
Right.
What, you know, if it's her choice and she's not making it based on anybody else's input, it has to be all about her. Or,
right.
You know, and there's, like we've reiterated in our own little circles, that there's no way, one way to be trans. There's no one trajectory. Just like I talked about being asked about getting facial femme.
Right.
do I need to do it? No. Would I probably do it had I the money? Probably.
Yeah.
But that's just for me. But I would never say that it's a necessary step for me to be happy.
Right.
You know, it's something that I'd love to do. Mm-hmm. And maybe one day I will. Who knows?
Yeah, but not all of us are Caitlyn Jenner.
No, we're not all. We can't fully transition in a month.
Yeah, or have Spirit days. Halloween Company make costumes of us.
Oh my God! Did you talk about that already?
No, I haven't. But anyway, we're gonna go away for a short break here, but we will be back. I'm gonna ask you guys to relax because we will be bringing more news to you, and that's actually the name of the song. It's called Relax. Don't do
that. Oh,
God. I'm just kidding. It's not, but it is called Relax. All right, we'll be right back. Queer Life Radio Show and stuff. Thank you.
Nuestro teléfono en cabina 707-545-0318. KBBF, la voz de tu comunidad.
Caminando, caminando.
KBBF 89.1, contigo, ayer, hoy y siempre.
Okay, you're listening to another easy moment. Oh, I'm just kidding. So.
Oh my God, please don't. Not unless you want the next half hour to be laughter all the way through.
This is true. And I mean, that's happened before. But
it's like listening to your voicemail message.
What? What's wrong with my voicemail message?
Have you listened to it recently?
No, I haven't.
You gotta listen to it.
Oh gosh. Please, everybody, don't call me. Anyway, next up on pinknews.co.uk, Thailand introduces first law to protect LGBT people. You heard that right. First law. What?
The first law. And these are your people.
These are...
Well, partly your
people. If you haven't heard the show, I am a trans woman, a transsexual woman. Yeah. I also happen to be from Thailand. I know that there is a group
a stereotype
that trans women from Thailand are ladyboys. Mm-hmm. Just as a disclaimer, a lot of the trans community will ask that you defer to their own personal opinions whether they would like to be called a ladyboy. Personally, if you call me a ladyboy, I'll probably laugh and be like, why, what?
Or Katoy.
Katoy, which is more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I will say, for those of you who can't see her on camera, she is a beautiful Thai lady.
And if you want to see me on camera, you can
go
to thequeerlife.org and watch the show, which is... all of basically me in a radio booth recording a live radio show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what does this news say about Thailand?
The country's first law specifically protecting LGBT people came into effect this week.
This Monday or like this week?
As in day before yesterday or the day after tomorrow or... Thai Parliament passed the 2015 Gender Equality Act in March. The law is designed to protect members of the LGBT community and aims to punish discrimination based on gender identity and sexual orientation. Those found guilty of discrimination may face up to 6 months in jail and a 20,000 baht fine.
Now, wasn't there... I might be confusing it with a story out of India, but I'm pretty sure something similar has happened in Thailand where they had a protest and a lot of trans women were arrested, but only the trans women. I don't know. I can't
remember. That was in India.
That was in India. Yeah. I thought so. But I'm trying to think. I don't know because it's been a while since I've been on the show, so I don't know if there was any news that we talked about previously out of Thailand.
Right. We haven't talked too much about Thailand.
Not really, other than when we make fun of you.
Yeah. I was born there. I didn't grow up there, okay?
Your accent's so good.
I know. Oh my gosh. Welcome.
Suetika.
I hate you. Anyway, this, you know, it's for the most part, I identify as American, and
I would hope so. You pretty much grew up here.
Yeah, and I speak American pretty well. but the thing that really kind of confuses me about this is I'd always been taught in terms of my own family, because I've been fairly well accepted in terms of my trans identity within my Thai family.
Yeah.
My mom communicates with the family very frequently over there, and they're like, oh, no problem. She looks beautiful. There's a lot of them here.
Yeah.
By them, she means...
Wait, what are you?
What? That's awful. Well, if we were in Thailand, I'd be able to sue you.
Yeah, because there's no new law.
Yeah. But anyway, the world's moving forward. Yeah. That's Thailand for you. This is you can find this article and more on thequeerlife.org. This is episode 57, Julia Serano interview. Here on KBBF 89.1 FM Calistoga and KWTF 88.1 FM Bodega Bay. I know you've been wanting to hear more of this about Kim Davis, our favorite county clerk.
Wait, don't we heart Kim Davis?
I feel like I need a bumper sticker. I heart Kim Davis.
Or a button.
Yeah, that would be great.
A little button, I heart Kim Davis.
I heart Kim Davis.
She's
anybody?
My hero.
Yeah.
She's standing up for what she believes in.
She's like Rosa Parks or the bus driver, or I'm getting it confused. Right?
The bus driver.
I mean, come on. For those of you that don't know, Kim Davis, who was the county clerk in Rowan County, Kentucky, big surprise, who has been denying to serve marriage licenses to same-sex couples, which as of the Supreme Court justice's ruling is now the law of the land.
I'm pretty sure with time and perspective, we're going to look back on her as the same way we look back on any individuals, and I'm sure this happened, I haven't looked it up, but any individuals back when interracial marriage was made law. Right. In other words, you could marry. I guarantee there were people who wouldn't marry, for instance, a black man, a white woman, or vice versa. Right. So, you know, they probably stood on their principles and whatnot and held out for a little while. But nowadays you look back at them and you feel sad for them, really, you know.
Right.
And, you know, how bad for them that they can't let go of that hatred. They can't let go of that bigotry. And they just got to hold on to it, and they got to throw the Bible at you in the process and say that that makes it legitimate, and it doesn't. Right? Throwing the Bible at something doesn't make your hatred legitimate.
I mean, doesn't our Constitution say that all men are created equal?
Yeah, all men.
Yeah, oh, that shoot. I mean, she did marry a transgender man to a cis woman.
Yeah, so she's technically already violated her religious belief in marrying what she would have viewed if she had known as a lesbian couple.
So,
obviously they're not.
She sinned unknowingly. Does that mean that she'll still go to hell?
I think so. At least purgatory, I don't know.
Right.
Ignorance of the law. I don't know. That's a human thing, but you know.
Well, basically, she's still banging on about something. Yeah. Joseph Patrick McCormick on pinknews.co.uk says, adamantly bigoted clerk Kim Davis, who went to jail rather than obey court orders instructing her to marry gays, has been released. What, has she been in jail all of like 48 hours?
Yeah. She's a martyr.
Yeah. Davis, the clerk, talk to Nelson Mandela. I mean,
yeah.
Come on. Davis, the clerk for Rowan County, Kentucky, made international news when she defied a string of court orders by refusing to grant marriage licenses to gay and lesbian couples, despite issuing marriage licenses being a large part of her job. Speaking at a rally organized by Republican presidential hopeful Mike Huckabee, Davis said in tears, quote, "I love you all so very much. I just want to give God his glory." His people have rallied, and you are a strong people. We serve a living God who knows exactly where each and every one of us is at. Keep pressing. Don't let down. U.S. District Judge David L. Branning issued an order yesterday granting her a conditional release as long as she does not interfere in the process by blocking same-sex marriage licenses. So, I mean, I first and foremost, as I've said on previous episodes, this is not by presenting this news here on the show, it's not anti-Christian. We're trying to spread here, and it's not saying that somebody who is standing up for their religious beliefs, there's nothing wrong for standing up with your religious beliefs,
mm-mm.
so long as it doesn't break the law.
If it doesn't break the law, and also if it infringes on somebody else's freedom and, you know, civil rights, stuff like that, that's where the law gets involved, is when, you know, we don't allow animal sacrifice. There are religions out there that practice animal sacrifice, you know, not very many, but there are a few, and we don't allow that because that's harming another individual, in this case an animal and whatnot. So we don't allow practices which cause to harm another individual, and in this case this is causing these individuals harm because it is now the law of the land. You know, so it's something that if she doesn't want to abide by the law, she doesn't need to have that job. She can go get another job where she won't have to do that.
Yeah.
You know, it's quite simple. I've read stories where there are people suggesting that those individuals who want to get married can go over the 30 minutes over to the next county to get married or whatever, because they'll marry over there, but they shouldn't have to.
Yeah, that's not, the law doesn't say go where you want, except if they don't want you, go to the one.
Yeah, go next
go
door.
To a different one.
Yeah, no.
Except if they don't want you either, which if that policy were allowed to be in effect, there would be probably still be states that are by and large.
And from what I've heard, since she's been in jail, they've been issuing the licenses out of her office, you know, from her assistants or whatever they are. But also that there have been people outside protesting whenever somebody goes in to get married with, you know, spouting really bad, hateful things, you know, and of course holding up signs.
Yeah.
which we want to get a hold of.
If you out there are an owner of one of these signs,
yeah.
Please send it to KBBF. I would love to.
You might have to blur out what it says.
Yeah, but I swear to you, I will take a picture and post it on social media.
That'd
holding
great,
this sign.
Yeah.
That'd be a highlight of 2015 for me.
Mm-hmm.
Moving on now to a little bit of science here. Kelsey Campbell Dollahan on Gizmodo.com. Shares with us, watch Elon Musk describe terraforming Mars to Stephen Colbert. Stephen Colbert, who was on the front of Time magazine recently in a very epic way. And I've got a short clip for you here. And for those of you that don't know, terraforming is turning a planet or moon or celestial object into a habitable Earth-like.
What? Habitable?
Habitable! Okay. Please excuse my Asian accent.
Oh my god.
Anyway, this is Elon Musk, who might be a super villain.
People called you the real Tony Stark. Okay, you've got your finger in so many different advanced technologies. As I said, SpaceX, Tesla, now you've got Solar City and the solar pack that people put in their houses. Are you sincerely trying to save the world?
I'm trying to do good things, yeah. I mean, saving the world is not, I mean.
But you're trying to do good things and you're a billionaire. I mean,
yeah.
That seems a little bit like either superhero or supervillain. You have to choose one.
You're trying to do useful things? I mean,
uh-huh.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the Tesla. I have a Tesla.
Yeah.
Okay, and I love it, I love it. You've got a new thing that you think is going. People are going to want for their Tesla. Can I, Jim? Can we show the footage of this? I think it's called. This thing is the power arm. Yeah. That is an extremely.
It's a snake bot charger.
It's a snake charger that automatically plugs into your car when you get home.
This looks a little wrong.
That really looks like the thing that jacks into the back of Neo's head in the Matrix.
Right.
All right, is that thing gonna attack me in my sleep?
It's, well, I, I wouldn't, for the prototype at least, I would recommend not dropping anything when you're near it.
Okay. Okay. All right. Now, another thing that you are talking about is you sincerely think that we should go to Mars, like that men and women should go to Mars.
Yeah.
Why do we want to go to Mars? It's uninhabitable.
It's very inhospitable. That's true.
It is. Like, you have to be in, like, domes and everything, and you're just
breathing. Initially?
Domes.
Yes.
Really? How long before we could turn Mars into some place where we could live?
It is a fixer-upper of a planet. At first, you're going to have to live in transparent domes, but eventually...
Yes, we're going to be huffing each other's stank.
Yeah. But eventually, you can transform Mars into an Earth-like planet.
How would you do that?
You'd warm it up. Just warm it up.
With a blanket or with what? How would you warm Mars up? You know, it's a long way away from the sun.
It's the fast way and the slow way.
Okay. Give me the fast way.
The fast way is drop thermonuclear weapons over the poles.
You're a super villain. That's what a super villain does.
Yeah.
Okay, everybody, that was Elon Musk on Stephen Colbert's...
So the verdict is that he is a supervillain.
That Elon Musk is a supervillain.
Yeah.
When he created PayPal and...
And he learned everything in Shul.
In Shul and getting everybody on electronic cars. And then he'll drop his mega EMP bomb to... stop the world. Yeah.
EMP bomb.
Anyway, that was from Kelsey Campbell, Delahan, and Gizmodo.com. Watch Elon Musk describe terraforming Mars to Stephen Colbert. That is from the science portion of the show, which indeed affects us all.
Speaking of the Mars and the upcoming mission to Mars, originally, I don't know if the list is officially formed or not of the astronauts that are going to go to Mars. Initially, one of the applicants was a transgender woman. I don't know if you knew that.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Remember? It was a long time ago. This is a while ago. Like, she was one of the applicants that they were looking at. Not just an applicant, but like somebody who filled out a form, but literally somebody who they were considering as a team member. I don't know if she got picked or what happened to that, but
yeah. That would be pretty incredible.
It would
This
be.
Is one small step for man, one great leap for transkind.
Like the little baby.
Yeah.
In that Airbnb.
Yeah.
Mankind, womankind, transkind.
Next up here is an article from planettransgender.com. Kelly Busey writes, judge rules against transgender students' use of correct bathroom. Gavin Grimm, a Gloucester County transgender high school junior's life was thrown into disarray last year after a couple of parents complained about his use of the boys' room. Gavin had been using the boys' room peacefully in accordance with school policy at the beginning of his sophomore year, but all that changed thanks to the interdiction of right-wing power broker Russ Moulton. Russ Moulton's group strong-armed the school board into changing their transgender policy from acceptance to one that does not recognize the need for allowing transgender students. U.S. District Judge Robert G. Del Mar, known for his right-wing advocacy from the bench, told Grimm that it was highly unlikely that he would grant the injunction early on and dismissed out of hand the U.S. Department of Justice statement of interest. Title IX of the Education Amendments of 1972 because it discriminates on the basis of sex, which the department states includes gender identity. Unbelievably, Del Mar questioned whether denying Grimm his gender identity or allowing him to express it would be damage to him psychologically. Judge Del Mar obviously isn't aware or even cares that 16 transgender teens and young adults have committed suicide this year alone for exactly those reasons.
So basically they're saying, because I don't understand why this is mentally damaging to you, therefore it's not real or not happening or
not a problem.
Yeah. Not a problem, because I don't know why that would bother you. It doesn't bother me, you know. Well, so why should it bother you? Obviously, you know. In other words, it's an issue that is so hard to explain to people.
Right.
And, you know, all of the writing that I do, I try over and over again to many, many times to kind of try to explain what that is to people, how to explain to individuals what it's like to be trans or what it's like to feel dysphoria or as Julia Serano calls it in her book, gender dissonance, right? It's what does that feel like? And really, all we can do is describe it and use metaphors and everything else like that, because there's not really the verbiage out there, the language to adequately describe what it is. And that experience differs from person to person.
Right.
It's not always the same. It's not always to the same extent, right? Some of us grow up hating our bodies. Some of us don't.
Yeah.
Some of us hate parts of it and not other parts, right? So the experience is all over the place. So even among transgender people, you can't always speak for the entire community, because the entire community doesn't even agree on what it is to be trans and what it even feels like. But there is common language out there in the community. But if you are not trans, there's nothing I can say or no way I can, no metaphor that I can use that would help you understand, because you just can't. So it's no surprise that this judge just doesn't understand.
Right. And this is not new news.
No.
I share this just to let you know that it's still happening. And it's like Mandy was saying, it's more than a feeling that's very hard to describe. And, mm-hmm. It's in the immortal words of a blue suede hooked on a feeling. I can't stop this feeling.
Oh, I thought it was Uga Chaka. Uga Chaka. that explains as much of what it is to be trans as anything.
Uga Chaka.
Uga Chaka, yeah.
Anyway, and on that note, we will be closing down this episode of the Queer Life Radio Show. I want to thank Mandy for joining the Queer Life on this episode and helping interview Julia Serrano from the last first hour. And again, if you are just tuning in right now, you have just missed the Queer Life Radio Show.
Aren't you lucky? No.
Fortunately for you, the Queer Life Radio Show, which is LGBT news, modern perspectives, roundtable discussions, and interviews, is available on the interwebs.
And it plays again on Monday, right?
And it plays again on Monday, and it plays again... No, it plays again on Tuesday.
And Wednesday.
And it plays again on Wednesday, yeah, okay. On KWTF.
See, I've been gone for a while.
It's okay, so here we are. And I want to say to you, have a wonderful, wonderful evening. Again, if you are in a position where you are feeling down or you feeling in a position of self-harm, find help, talk to somebody. We have resources on the website, and there is a trans lifeline, which we have on the website, thequeerlife.org. Anyway, I hope you have a wonderful night.
Girl, you just don't realize what you do to me when you hold me in your arms so tight. You let me know everything's all right. I'm hooked on a feeling. I'm high on believing that you're in love with me. Lips as sweet as candy.